Hello, retro fans. It was quite a lot of work and it took quite some time to go through all, or let's say, a lot of the features of the Ultimate 64, the new board made by Gideon. And a lot of people have been really waiting for this board, this replacement board, or whatever we want to call this, as kind of a successor to the Ultimate 1541 series. And finally it has arrived, and I spent almost 2 or 3 days now working with a lot of things with this board, and checked which programs, which demos, which games are working and which not, which hardware can be used with the board, what's required to use it with original SIDs, with SIDs replacements and all that stuff. And the question that came to my mind as well is, what's going to be the usage of this board anyway? So the thing is that if we're looking for a C64, let's say, device or C64, unit, I don't know how to describe this in the best words. So is this really what we are looking for? Is this a C64 at all? Is it something way beyond the normal C64? And so it came to my mind to compare this to a normal setup of a C64, and I created kind of an well, collection, or an probably a setup that could be used in the way as we maybe have done this 10 years ago, and some of us are still doing this. So what we can see in this picture is a C64-2 with two floppy drives, with an original monitor and this tape device. I've left out the cables and all that stuff. It's just for demonstration purpose only. And I placed a couple of floppy disks, as well as cartridges, as well as tape. Tapes, just to create some kind of an impression what's all combined on the Ultimate 64. So, and with this having in mind, I mean, if you're really looking for a very compact setup where you have all the flexibility to use one or two floppy drives, to use cartridges, to use a tape drive and all that stuff, without having all the hassle with the original software, or without the space requirements of the original equipment, and just to mention all the power supplies required to run the setup as well, then the Ultimate 64 is definitely something to look for. I mean, if you still got your C64 in whatever form, and if you have an Ultimate 1541 2 Plus or something like this, then perhaps it's not really required to go for the Ultimate 64 board, because this would provide almost the same functionality. The only advanced you would have is the HDMI video output and the option to run two SIDs on it. But this is just, let's say, to create some kind of context. And within this context, I was going through a couple of options and want to see whether the Ultimate 64 is really providing what we are looking for. So, and the first steps required for this whole thing is that you equip the board with a certain set of ROMs. So it's actually empty when you get this, and it's required to have the basic ROM, the kernel ROM, a character ROM, and the floppy drive ROM copied to the board. And I got a lot of ROM dumps from my original devices, and you can use the ROMs from the Wise emulator, for example, if you have no ROMs at hand. Or you can go and buy commercial ROMs like the Jiffy DOS, for example, and use them on your Ultimate 64. And it takes quite little moment to understand how this ROM handling is done on the Ultimate 64, because you have original ROMs, factory ROMs, and custom ROMs. And it is really required to sit down and spend some time and create some kind of structure if you're going to use different ROMs, so that you have an understanding which setting is using which ROM. And I have to admit, at the beginning I was struggling with this a little bit. I had a hard time to get the Jiffy DOS on my 1541 emulated drive on the Ultimate 64, because especially here you have to use the option custom ROM, whereas for the kernel and the basic ROM you can use the standard ROM option. So that's a little bit strange, but anyway, I got it to work at the end. And so I went through the first setup of the board, and that's not so difficult at all. And then I started to check a couple of things that were already on my Ultimate 2 USB stick. And one of the first thing I've tested was the cartridge image of Lufttrausers, just to see whether this game is working on the C64. And we can have some audio as well. So what we hear right now is the emulated SID of the Ultimate 64, and this is quite a useful feature if you really start with a game or with the Ultimate 64 at all and have no old parts at hand. You can really start out of the box and you have some sound. And I started to compare the sound of newer games against older games, just to get an impression how the SID emulation works and how it sounds. So I wouldn't call it top notch, but the sound emulation is quite okay, so to say. It sounds like a C64, but if you're a die-hard SID fan, then you will have some problems with it. I found no way to configure whether I want to have an 8580 or a 6581 SID. So the board seems to use the same SID emulation regardless to what game you're playing. And this creates some distinct issues within the game set. And well, that's not my main interest. I mean, I have never been a big fan of emulated SID sounds. And I thought this whole SID replacement approach of ARM SID, Spin SID and FPGA SID creates some kind of twilight zone. It is still different to a pure emulated sound. And the next thing I was testing as well is whether the gamepad is working. And I'm using the Nunchuck 64 adapter for this. And actually my video got stuck somewhere in the middle. No, it keeps running. I'm sorry. So yes, so I started Sam's Journey as well as a disk image this time. So that's basically not a cartridge file. Just to see how this multiple disk image handling is done by the Ultimate 64. And if you're used to the 1541 Ultimate 2 Plus whatever device, then you know how to change this. And the interesting thing is that you cannot create kind of a list, or at least I haven't found an option for this. I thought on the Ultimate 1541 it was possible to create images with a following name or something like this, and by a press of a button the Ultimate just stepped to the next disk image. So I couldn't figure out how this is going to work on the Ultimate, since you got just one button to operate this whole device. But anyway, that's perhaps a different topic. So I played short time with Sam's Journey, just to see how the game runs, how it feels, how it looks like. and how it sounds. And if you have played Sam's Journey on a normal C64 with an 8580 SID, then you know that this sounds pretty impressive, and on the Ultimate 64 it tends to sound a little bit, let's say, flat or a little bit unmotivated, I don't know, but it's not as impressive as the original. So the next thing is this whole story about HDMI scanlines. This is something we're going to cover a little bit later in the video. And what's really interesting is that if you work with disk image, then you are able to create a floppy drive sound emulation. And this got mixed into your HDMI sound or in your normal sound output. And this creates really some feeling of having a real floppy drive. So I'm just checking a couple of options here in the Ultimate 64 menu. We got a lot of cartridge images already loaded into the Ultimate 64. So you can choose your final cartridge, your action replay cartridge, whatever you want to use. And you can use the ROI as well, as we were able to do with the 1541 Ultimates as well. So you can set a date and time. This is very useful if you're going to create disk images with the Ultimate 64. Then they have the right timestamp on your USB stick. And indeed, you can configure your interface with your preference of color. And you can say whether the interface is going to be an overlay on HDMI, or is it going to freeze the whole Ultimate 64. So the thing here is that this freeze option is what we are used to with the 1541 Ultimates. And the overlay option is pretty nice if you operate the Ultimate 64 on an HDMI device. And the thing here is, if you set this to overlay and you connect the Ultimate 64 to an S-Video monitor or S-Video TV set or something like this, you won't see any Ultimate 64 menu anymore. So you have to go back to HDMI, reconfigure this so that you get the freeze option back. Then you will see the Ultimate menu in the S-Video mode as well. So this is something you have to keep in mind. But the other cool thing with the overlay is that this won't stop your C64 experience. So if you're in the middle of a game and you hit the button to get the Ultimate menu, the game keeps playing, for example, or the demo keeps playing. And this is very nice, especially if you're keen on uninterrupted sounds and all that stuff. But it will still be visible in your picture. The cool feature would be to have the S-Video output as the main output and the HDMI output as the menu output, for example. So this is actually not achievable, but anyway, could be something for the near future. So I was testing the bare essentials, which won't run on the C64 Mini. So the Ultimate 64 is able to run this. And the next thing I was testing was Café Odd. That's an old Deflex, old demo from Reflex. And usually this shows some problems with several disk loaders. It keeps running, but it won't load the next parts. And fortunately, surprisingly, I don't know, on the Ultimate 64 it works very fine. So it loads the next part and everything is as expected. So as a old demo, you can choose whether you want the old sound chip or the new sound chip. And I couldn't distinguish a very big difference in sound, I have to say. So if you set this to a 6581, the filter effects sound a little bit different compared to the 8580, but the filter effects of the sound emulation are quite, well, soft, so to say, and therefore you won't hear a huge difference. So as a next thing, I was going to test whether I can use a USB keyboard. So, and to test this, in order to test this, I connected my Amiga 600 keyboard with an Kira version 2 to the Ultimate 64, and I can use a USB keyboard, and that's quite comfortable because this is a little bit smaller. And the strange thing is that there is no option to choose which layout you're going to use. So if you're familiar with the C64, it is available with different keyboard layouts, and not that much, but at least. And if you're going to use a USB keyboard, you get a very strange second layer configuration. So if you're used to press Shift 2 for the file name, for example, then you will end up with a different character here in this case. And that's a little bit strange. And as I said, I couldn't find any way to configure the layout of the keyboard. But having this USB option, it is quite interesting if you're not going to use the Ultimate 64 in a normal case. If you want to place this just somewhere in a, I don't know, box-like case or something like this and want to operate this via USB, then that's a very nice feature. Here I'm testing a synth card as kind of a synthesizer program, just to step a little bit deeper into the sound emulation. And as you can hear, the filter effects are working quite fine. That's okay. But the whole sound sounds a little bit kind of flat. And as the next thing, I was testing Messiah. And without going into the details, I was just trying to load a demo file from the cartridge. And while hitting open, the whole emulation or the whole program just freezed. So I wasn't able to load anything into a Messiah, and I can't check whether it is working or not. So there seems to be an issue with the cartridge, and that's kind of strange because on the reloaded MK1 there was a problem running Messiah. On the MK2 it's fixed, and I was expecting that the Ultimate 64 is able to run Messiah as well, but this needs to be addressed. The next thing I was testing is Hunter's Moon, which is a Gmod 2 cartridge, a cartridge that's able to save game states and all that things. And we can have a listen to the sound. So the sound is quite okay, but unfortunately after this part of the intro the cartridge gets stuck, and even if you try to avoid the intro at all, you can't get into the game. So actually the Ultimate 64 won't work with Gmod 2 cartridges. That's the same for Luftrausers as well as Sam's Johnny. So I went on and tested Galencia as cartridge, and fortunately this works fine. You can have a listen to the sound as well. So the game plays as expected. There is no issue with the game at all. and there is no lag or something like this, and everything works fine, so that's not really a problem. The next thing I was testing is a very, very old cartridge. It's a Moon Patrol that's ranging back to 1984 or something like this. And I had some struggle with the controls at the very beginning. I haven't played the game for a very long time now. But overall, there is no issue with running old cartridges as well. So this is working fine on the Ultimate 64. And if you have a bunch of old cartridges, I think everything is going well then. And then as the next thing, I went on and tested Sydney Hunter as a new cartridge game as well. And without bothering you so long with my Moon Patrol gameplay, let's move on to the next thing. And the interesting thing is that Sydney Hunter on disk drive is rather slow to play, because the loading times are a little bit longer compared to other games. But as a cartridge games, there's almost no lag in loading and all that stuff. So it's very, very funny to play the game. And I really love the graphics. I never made that much progress into the game, because you have to start from the very beginning over and over again as soon as you have died a couple of times. But anyway, this game runs very well as well, so there's no issue with this. And as a next kind of a last game test, I was going to play Organism as a disc version on the Ultimate 64. So here we can have a listen to the sound as well, because this is really impressive. So basically the soundtrack has a very dark mood and creates a very good feeling of being almost alone on this huge ship. And as mentioned before, the sound emulation sounds a little bit well, flat, a little bit without the right feeling. But well, we got the option to use normal SID chips as well, so we're not going to complain that much about the sound emulation. It is, as I said, a good start, and if you want to listen to a couple of two SID songs or something like this, then it's probably easier than to get quite expensive SID chips on the market. So then I went on and tested a couple of demos, and here I already started to work with different SID chips. And the interesting thing is that you got a variety of options to configure your sound on the board. So if you're using two SIDs or two emulated SIDs or a mix of it, you can configure the volume per channel, you configure the bellings and all that stuff. You configure how loud your drive is going to be, and you can even configure tape sounds and all that stuff, which we're going to hear a little bit later. So going through the demo is probably not the main purpose of this video. We just have a short listen to the sound. So and I have used this option of configuring the volumes per SID to compare the sound of the sound emulation against normal SIDs against replacement SIDs and all that stuff. And it's very handy if you have some volume differences, then you can adjust them that you have a centered sound. And you can even configure that your floppy drive is just on one channel and the music is playing on the other channel, depending on your audio setup. So you got a lot of flexibility within the audio menu. And I have to admit that I spent a lot of time in this menu going through the different options. And that's very interesting that we have so many possibilities to work with the sound here. And my ultimate 6581 test is always a light force, because this comes with a very sensitive adjustments of the filters. And if you have a 6581 SID chip with strong filters, you won't hear most of the sounds in this music played by light force. And therefore I'm using this to test emulated SIDs as well. And it's very interesting when we compare this to each other against the emulated SID. So if you listen to this video with headphones and you have a strange stereo impression, this is the case when the emulated SID and the normal SID are not playing the very same thing, and that's basically based on the emulation. And the next thing I was testing is the FPGA SID Config Guru. That's the program you need to configure the FPGA SID. So I stepped deep into the usage of the FPGA SID in conjunction with the Ultimate 64 board. And the next thing I was testing as well was whether a USB joystick or joypad is working. I tested three different devices and none of them were working. So that's actually a feature that's probably not implemented, so, or it's not intended to be or something like this, I don't know. So this wasn't really successful. And then I moved on to test another stuff, and that's going to be the D81 image format. So got a lot of converted games in the D81 format to avoid disk changes during the game. And the interesting thing is that you can go into an image, then you can run a single program, but you can't mount the whole image, and therefore if the program starts to load parts from the disk, it's going to crash or simply get stuck in the middle of it. So the D81 is actually not supported, or not in a way I'm used to be, and therefore it may need an update, or it may need a different approach. So actually I'm not sure what's going to be the issue here. And therefore the Pi 1541, for example, or an SD2IC device has some advance, because they can handle D81 images very well. And then the next interesting thing is that the Ultimate 64 has still a tape connector, and you can use tape image files as well. And if you know that the 1541 Ultimate 2 and 2 Plus, they come with a tape connector, and you can load tape images directly through your tape port. And with the Ultimate 64, it's not longer required to have a cable connected. So the tape image is directly streamed internally to your tape port, and you can even configure tape sounds as well, so that you have the sound of the normal tape device. So let's see whether we can hear it right now. Probably take a moment to start. It's actually a little bit quiet, but you can configure the volume of the tape sound as well. Now we can hear it quite clearly. And as mentioned before, we can have game sound and tape or floppy sound at the very same time, and depending on your own preference you can set the volumes as you like. So then I was just shortly playing Starfish by Richard Bayless. It's probably not the most advanced shooter we have seen so far, but I really like the graphics, and it has a very smooth feeling. And in opposition to other games, your glider, your starship moves very, very quick and very fluid. So this was just my test of internal tape files. And then I went on to test the Tapuino, which is a tape drive, tape recorder emulation device, which is physically connected to your tape port. And I was looking for whether this works with the Ultimate 64 as well. And even here we can have tape sounds. So if you're a fan of old tape, old tapes and old tape games, then you can still use all the stuff on the Ultimate 64. And I suppose that even a normal tape recorder will work on the Ultimate 64, since this is going to be the same like at the Tapuino, for example. So, and then it was raised by a YouTube comment whether the Check 64 will work on the Ultimate 64 as well. And this requires some kind of preparation, because there is no physical user port like we've used to have this on a normal C64. There's a connector on the board which mimics the user port, and usually the Check 64 is using kind of a dongle on the user port to connect certain pins. And I was just recreating the very same thing by using short cables, and did this on the Ultimate 64 directly. And as we can see, the Ultimate 64 fails a couple of tests, and I think that's basically a timing issue. The Check 64 is very timing sensitive to check certain parts on the board, and this isn't working very well so far. As the next thing, I was interested whether I can copy files from one USB stick to another. And as an initial step, I was mounting disk images on those two USB sticks, on drive 8 and drive 9. And then I tried this Ultimate 64 copy, which is included already, to copy disk images from one drive to another. And unfortunately, I couldn't figure out how this is going to work with the UltiCopy. So perhaps there's a trick, or it's not possible, I can't say. And therefore I went on to use a different method. And for this I was just mounting the image as well. You can create disk images on those drives or on those USB sticks. And then I went on to use a built-in cartridge. This, I was using the Action Replay cartridge, because this comes with a disk copy option. And this feature is quite interesting. So if you and build your C64 in a normal case, having the Ultimate 64 as your main board, and you want to use a USB stick on the internal USB port, and you don't want to open your C64 all the time, then you can simply use a second USB stick, plug it to a USB port pointing to the outside. Then you simply copy a disk image from one USB stick to another without the need of opening the C64. So this makes this whole thing very compact and just reduces the amount of work required to copy files and all that things. I guess in the future this is going to be going to work over the network as well, perhaps over a wireless connection, something like this, which is actually not implemented yet. So I haven't tested the wired network connection because I have no wired connection here on my desk. I'm just using a wireless network, and therefore I can't say whether we can already access files over the network. So anyway, as mentioned, I was using the Action Replay copy, and I was able to copy the disk to the internal drive, and this has worked very well. And since I was working with my SID test disk, I went on and tested the SID play, and the interesting thing here is as well that we can use multiple drives for this program as well, and without any big surprise the program works fine, loads the SIDs and plays them on the Ultimate 64 as well. So here I was in the middle of working with the FPGA SID, getting it to work in stereo mode. I will talk about the FPGA a little bit later in the video. So I went on and tested the ARM SID, which I have received just a few days ago. And that's the configuration program, and as we can see, it has detected the ARM SID, and I was able to configure the ARM SID as I wanted. And yeah, I was playing with the different filter settings just to test whether the setup program is working fine. And as I said, everything is really working perfectly. We can flash the ARM SID and it keeps the configuration. That's actually no problem at all. It is very important that if you want to configure an ARM SID, an FPGA SID, or the SwinSID Ultimate, that they need to be configured to run on the D400 address. So that's really important, otherwise the program won't find them. So here the SwinSID Ultimate is running as a second SID on a different address, and therefore the configuration program can't find the SwinSID Ultimate. So I went back to the Ultimate 64 menu and configured that the SwinSID Ultimate runs on a socket with the address D400. And as I have done this, the program was detecting the SID as well. SID in socket 1 and SID in socket 2, I have no idea what this option is doing. I was testing different combinations and wasn't able to spot any difference. And by switching back to the configuration program, we see immediately that it found the SwinSID Ultimate, and I was able to configure the SwinSID Ultimate as well. So, and as the next thing after I was done with the setup of the SwinSID Ultimate, I went on and tested whether both SIDs are playing in stereo as well. And I was using this hexadecimal 2 SID from Dane, and that's a very cool sounding SID file, and let's have a listen to it. So as we can see, we can work with the volume, we can work with the panning, and everything can be set to your own preference. That's a very interesting thing with this whole Ultimate setup menu. And then as a last or almost last thing, I went on and started to work with the FPGA SID. And the interesting thing, the FPGA SID provides a stereo SID emulation on board. And the thing is how to get this onto the Ultimate 64. On a normal board, you would use connectors like this, and then you go to your CPU, for example, and grab the required address lines. But on the Ultimate 64, there is no CPU in this form as we are used to it. But fortunately, there is a so-called FPGA I/O, and I soldered myself some connector to it so that I was able to use this this clamp to grab the signal from the second pin. And this is either the A5 or the A8 signal, the address line signal, and therefore the FPGA is able to listen to a different address as well. So as a next thing, I was trying to get the sound onto the board. I mean, getting the sound from the FPGA is quite simple in my configuration. This is still a prototype, but this is almost the very same for the final product. So I'm using an external stereo connector to get the sound, but my interest was to get the stereo sound onto the board as well, to use all the mixer settings we have seen previously. And therefore, I need to route the sound of the second SID to the socket of the second SID, and that's the purpose of this gray cable here, which is connected to pin 27 of the second socket. And this needs to be soldered on the bottom of the FPGA SID to a certain point, and then this whole setup was working as well. And as you can see, you can use an external stereo connector on the Ultimate 64 as well, to get some kind of pure sound without floppy drive and all that noise and all that stuff. And you can use in parallel the sound routing through your HDMI or through your video ports as well. So that's basically very, very easy. So, and then the most interesting question raised by a couple of people on Twitter and on YouTube, so I'm sorry, I'm not going to mention every single one who is asking the question, but is the thing with the lag test. And I was going to use a quite similar setup I have used in the past, but this time I was going to use this specific joystick, because this is already equipped with an LED. And here we can see when I'm going to press a button, the fire button. And the very interesting thing is that we can use auto fire here as well, and therefore we are independent from button presses and all that stuff. So, and as a first thing, I started with the joystick over the HDMI output, and here we can see that it takes about 5 to 6 frames until the signal is processed. And as a comparison, I did this on S-Video then as well, just to see whether there's a huge difference. So here the S-Video signal is processed by the FrameMeister, which is an HDMI upscaler, and we have here almost the very same result. So I can't spot a major difference between those two. And as a next thing, I went on and did the joystick test on the reloaded MK2, just to compare the same FrameMeister processing. Unfortunately, my frames were counting in the opposite direction, but as we can see, it's about 5 to 6 frames as well, so that's very comparable. And as a next step, I was testing the so-called floppy blink test. And I started with HDMI, and we can see that this takes about 3 to 4 frames until the signal is shown on the screen. And I did this with the S-Video as well, which is a pretty close result too. And what we have to keep in mind here is that I'll show you this in the conclusion. I recorded the video with 100 Hz and 100 frames per second, so we have to divide the number by 2 to get the total lag. And if we see that the floppy test provides about 4 frames in 100 frames per second, so we end up with 2 frames in total, and the joystick test is around, let's say, 3 frames per second, 3 frames in total. So surprisingly, it takes some time to process the signal from the joystick, but that's the very same on the MK2 board as well. So that's perhaps a software issue, so that's not related to the video lag or something like this. But the interesting thing is that between the HDMI output and the S-video output, there's almost no difference, at least not within the discrimination I was using in this comparison or in this method. So, and I mean, 2 frames is a pretty good number for an HDMI output compared to a normal CRT TV, for example, where we have almost zero lag at all. It is still a lot, but compared, for example, to the C64 Mini, which ends up with 6 to 7 frames in total, it is indeed much, much better. And then as the next thing, I was interested in whether the video output of HDMI and S-video is showing any difference. And this is a little bit tricky. View on the video. a little bit due to the fact that there is no real manual for the Ultimate 64. So most of the things I figured out was just by searching on Lemon 64 and Forum 64, and there's some kind of a wiki about certain things on the Ultimate 64, but overall it's actually a little bit poor documented. So compared to the MK2, for example, it feels a little bit unfinished, so to say. And hardware wise, I mean, it's a very small board. It's quite solid built, so the connectors are stable, there's no issue with this. Everything looks fine so far. I dislike kind of the main button, which has some kind of instability. And if you just keep in mind that this button is used for almost everything to operate this whole Ultimate 64, to bring up the menu, to bring up the configuration screens and all that stuff, to perform a reset, to switch on off the whole device, I have some concerns whether this thing has a very long life. So compared to an MK2 board, this is not perfect, so to say. The user user port, well, that's a personal taste. I'm not sure whether this is really going to be a big issue. Some people have a lot of things connected to the user port. There's going to be a breakout cable to get this functionality back. Personally, I'm not using the user port very often. I've used it in the past to synchronize my Messiah C64s, but this can be done over a MIDI connection as well. So that's not really an issue. And well, overall, this board works fine. It is still in progress. I'm looking forward to the next firmware upgrades to see whether certain things got fixed and if the whole functionality becomes more and more usable. And as a final conclusion, if you compare this to an MK2 board, it is, I have to say, a different approach. So the MK2 board still utilizes a lot of the original ICs, and if you a guy like me who likes to test different ICs, to test different setups, to switch between PAL and NTSC, for example, to throw in SID chips, and then I think the MK2 board is still the better choice, because here you have the chance just with the flick of a lever to remove the SID, bring it back, whereas on the Ultimate 64 it is not as easy, because here you have a standard socket, something like this, and it's really hard to remove a SID from a socket like this. So basically, in terms of functionality, these are very different concepts. This is kind of an original C64, where you have all the options outside of your C64. You got here the chance to flash certain ROM images using an USB connection, which is pretty nice. And in terms of functionality, that's going to be almost the same on the Ultimate 64 by just using USB sticks, for example. But overall, this is just a normal C64. Compared to the Ultimate 64, this is more than just a C64. You have a lot of possibilities which are not possible without additional hardware here. But that's your own personal preference, whether you want to go for this or for this. I mean, it's nice to have both of them, to play with both of them. It's very interesting, it's very geeky. But in terms of usage, you really have to know what you're going to do, and then you have to choose whether this or this is the best option. So I can't say this is bad and this is good, or vice versa, I don't know. Both of them are very good boards, and I'm looking forward to the future, to the progression of the Ultimate 64. So basically that's all for today, and it's already long enough. If you have any questions, comments, suggestions, if you want me to do certain things with the board, to test something, and to run through different configurations, something like this, feel free to use your ideas in the comment section, or you can find me on Twitter as well, and then we can have an open discussion about the features and all that stuff of the Ultimate 64. And well, basically that's all. feel free to retweet the video as well. And if you want to stay informed, then please follow me on Twitter or please subscribe to my channel. It's absolutely for free and you get a chance to be interactive with the next content of my videos. So, anyway, thank you very much for watching. See you for the next video. Bye bye.